Okay, so good morning, good afternoon, good evening to one and all joining from all of the world. Welcome to Letterkenny Island Developers Group. Today is our fourth session where we're going to talk about Lightning Web Components and how we can work with Salesforce data and integrate data with Lightning Web Components. For our Trailblazer community group, you can follow us on Twitter at LK underscore SF underscore devs. And you can follow us on Facebook at LK Trailblazers. For some of the reasons, our account was blocked for some time. Now Twitter handle is again active, so you can follow us now. And you have the chatter group where we'll keep on posting the presentations and all the code material which we do for the demo. And you can join our Trailblazer community group for all upcoming events there. I'm Nishant Singh Pawar, a community group leader, working with Pramerica as Salesforce developer and consultant in Letterkenny, and also having 6 years of experience working on Salesforce implementations and its Salesforce certification. I am Trailhead Ranger, loves music, plays sometime guitar, and come from Udaipur in India. So that's about me, and now action. So just keep your video off and on mute to avoid disturbance, and then you can put all your queries and questions on LWC query. So this is the page where we have all the queries, and I think we have good number of FAQs already documented here. You can go through these queries also to look out for any questions you have in your mind before asking them. Maybe they are already answered here. Then coming next. So today's our speaker, Sahil. So Sahil, if you can introduce yourself and take it over.
Thank you. Let me present my screen. So let me know once you are able to see my screen.
It's loading. Yeah, we can see it now.
Okay, great. Good morning, good evening, everyone. So I'm Sahil, and I have like 9 years of IT experience and now 6 years in Salesforce ecosystem. I've worked in various roles, started with a developer, then senior developer, tech lead, tech architect, and also taken up the one of the role of corporate trainer. So I've been doing these trainings from like last 5 years for companies. In my current role, like I work as a director at MTX Group, and I manage our learning and certification, and work as a tech arc for a lot of other internal projects which we run. So this is all about me. So you can just follow me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is Sahil Batra. Batra has double A and 18 with it. And we can be connected there. And whatever training session I do for any of the group, definitely I will post it there, and you can see all those updates there as well. Okay, so moving on to our session. So these were the few topics which we covered in our session. Last session, I could say the session three. So we have seen like how events work, how we can create a custom event, and how we can pass data from our child to parent. Then we have also seen like how we can add our event listener programmatically, or we'd use a declarative approach in that. Then we have seen the use of bubbles too, like how your event flows from your parent to child, and if you want to handle it at child to parent, and if you want to handle it at grandparent as well, how that happens. Then we have also seen the communication between the independent components. If you have two components onto your same page, how they communicate with each other. So there we used our PubSub library, which is already written by Salesforce. We have seen what different methods it add function it has, how we import them, and later we use them for communication between the two, I could say, standalone components. And we have also seen the similar concept, like how exactly we can write our code, like if we have any of the utility method, how we export them and use them into our already existing or a newly built Lightning Web Component. So this is what we have done in our last session. And if you have missed some part of it or the complete session, you can always go and check our recordings on YouTube. Okay, so moving with today's session. So today we'll see how exactly we work with Salesforce data. So whatever we have done so far, it was all static data. So I was just putting the static data, the contact data, which I took earlier, and we were playing with that. But now today we'll see how exactly we can query our data from our database, like how exactly we can integrate our Apex with our Lightning Web component. And also we have few of the already existing standard based components which are there, which are used for creation of record, viewing your record, editing record. So we'll look into them as well. And another is like how your Apex work with your LWC. So these are the two topics we'll see today. So if I talk about our Salesforce data, so we use our base component, which are built on Lightning Data Services. Then we use our wire adapter and functions. So we'll talk about them. What are those? And I will just show you one of the reference as well into our documentation. And third is we use Apex, like where we can just do anything. It's like read the record, update it, delete it, multiple records. So there we'll see how exactly those things works. Now, moving on to the next slide. So we have our Lightning Data Service. So it's like built on user interface API. It supports almost all of your custom and standard object, few external object, person account and custom metadata. So those are not supported. The best part of your Lightning Data Service is, as we have seen in Aura as well, it respect our object level access, the field level access, and the security settings we have. So if you don't have any access to the field, definitely you cannot go and create, put value into that field. If you don't have access to a record, you cannot see those, I could say, records there. If you don't have any access to your object, if you don't have create access, you cannot create the record. So there the LDS plays a big role. So we have three components, which are our base components. So Lightning Record Edit Form, View Form, and another one is I could say combination of both, Lightning Record Form. So if you anytime go to your documentation, you will find a lot of stuff about them, like into your components library. But today we'll see a few important things, how these can be used, few small syntaxes and all. And then we'll see how we use Apex with our Lightning Web Components. So in our Lightning data service, we'll be using our wire adapters as well. So it's like a service which is written, and it has pre-built functions which are there into some of the libraries. We import them and use our adapter services to get those data. So it's like it's a pretty much standard. You pass some data to it, and it in return it gave you something in return. So the few are the standard things. Definitely we'll write Apex code and use the wire service to get that data from Apex as well. So we'll see how exactly we use that. Then we will use Apex methods. So we have to import them. Definitely here we don't have a concept of controller, that you write controller equal to your Apex class name. But here we have to import those methods which we have written into our Apex, into our JavaScript file, and directly we can use them. Now for using them, we have our two ways. Either you can use a wire service, or you can use do an imperative call. So we'll see the difference between them, when to use what, then what is the benefit of one over another. So we'll see that as well. And as I told you earlier, if you remember my, I think it was a second session, whenever we pass data from parent to child, whatever records we pass, those are, I could say, immutable. You cannot change it. So here the same concept stays here. So whatever we get from our Apex and all, we make a shallow copy and make those changes. So we'll see that as well. And LDS also supports the cache. So whatever records we have, those are stored into your cache. And whenever some change happens into your database, or your cache is old, like the timeout has happened, in that case, it get you the updated record. So we'll see that as well. But if you do not get an updated record, what exactly you can do to get the updated record. So I have a demo for that as well, and we'll see that. Okay. So talking more about our Lightning Data Services, it do a lot of work, I could say, how exactly it works and why should we use it. It's like it increase our performance It uses a cache, so every time if you have to query a record, it checks it. If it is not changed into a database, it get it from the cache only. If something is changed, that means you change something into your record, definitely that cache get invalidated, get expired, and you get the new version or updated record. Okay. And whenever we make the calls, it bulkify it and it prevent the, I could say, recursive and duplicate calls. So this is something which is already maintained inside the framework. You don't have to worry much about it, but yes, you can always use these base component and they will perform better. And we'll see how these base component work. So whenever you have to create a record, edit a record, view it or delete, so there we can make use of these base components. Okay. So these are the three components which we have. Edit, as name says, whenever you want to use it in editable mode, anything you want to edit or create, we can use our edit form. Anything you want to display only, it's like you want to only view the record, there we use view form. And lighting record form, as I told you, it's a combination of both the edit and view. So it supports various modes, various attributes it has based on the values which we give for those attributes. They perform into different ways. So we'll see everything today. This is a screenshot which I took from one of the I could say blog, where it was just comparing these, like where you which base component can be used for creating a record, which can be used for editing a record, where you can control the layouts, where it could be a read-only mode, can you give a custom layout fields or not. So those things are there. So as we have done into our last three session, everything is our hands-on. So today also we'll be doing the same, less on theory and more on hands-on, so that you understand the concept and you understand how we can use these to implement our real-time scenario or the requirements which we have in our projects. Okay. So starting with our demo part. So as I told you, we have our three base components. So we'll first go with them, that how those can be used to read the records. If you want to read a record, if you want to query a record, you don't have to write any of your SQL query. Still, your Lightning Data Service exists and on which these components are built upon. And whenever you pass them the ID and object API, automatically it query and give you the result, and those we can use onto our projects or onto our Lightning Experience pages based on the requirement. So let me just. So we'll start with our first component. Let me just quickly comment out few of the things and then we'll go one by one. So if you see my screen, we have our Lightning record form. So this is, I could say, the combination of both. So if you want to edit a record or if you want to view a record, so we can make use of our Lightning record form. And these are the few, I could say, attributes which we pass. So what I have done, let me open the JavaScript file as well. Okay. So I have declared one of the, I could say two, not even one, we have declared two properties. One is record ID and second is our object API name. So I can give you a brief about them. So if we want to get, for example, I have a page where I'm using our Lightning record form and I want to make it generic. That means if I put my component onto opportunity record page, should act for opportunity. If I put it on contact, it should work for contact. If I put it on what we say account, it should work for account. So what exactly we can do, we can create our two properties, and we have to create them as public properties, record ID and object API name. So these are the two things which we can use. What happens if you use this web Lightning web component onto your record page? Automatically Flamework will add a record ID and object API name. So here I have hard coded it, because I will see that as well, how it works if you don't hard code it. So we'll talk about more on this, but yes, if I talk about my first demo, we have created our Lightning record form. I have taken a record ID. So you can always hard code it. You can pass it from the parents. It depends how you want to use it. Second, object API name. So I'm not using our JavaScript property. I have just hard coded the object API name as account. Then the third is our layout type. So it takes two values, full and compact. So what this full do, basically, if you have your standard screen where you go and create a new record, so whatever field comes up, whatever fields you have set up onto your page layouts, all fields will get included automatically. Okay. And if you give it like a compact, so whatever you have or whatever fields you have into your compact layout, those fields will get added onto your Lightning web component. Okay. Then if I talk about mode, so it has three value: view, edit, and read only. So what this view mode do? It display you all the records. It display you all the records, but you have an option to edit them. So you can double click a field, or you can just click on edit button. It change into editable mode. You type change something and click on save. So view mode is can be converted into a editable mode as well. Okay, and if you give it a edit value, it comes in editable mode. Whatever you type, just save it. It gets saved. And read only mode is the third mode, where it's only view. That means you are not allowed to update it. So you don't get a edit option as well, and you cannot update any of the field values. Okay, so here I have given view. That means it will display us in non-editable mode, but still we can convert it into a editable mode. Then whatever fields it will display, how many columns we want, 1, 2, 3. So if you don't give anything, it display everything into one column one by one. Okay. And then we have on submit. So what happens in case of this? Definitely in LDS, you don't have to write fire the updates and all. So whenever you click on submit or whenever you click on save, basically it automatically create record or update the record. But if we want to perform something, that if something gets submitted, I want to perform something, then there I can definitely write my logic there. Okay, so there is an option to we have an option to even prevent a default. Like once you click on save there, it perform a lot of default operations. So we have option to prevent it from submitting. Then you perform something, and then later you can submit your record as well for updation. Okay. These are the things we have, and if you see the documentation, these are the things which are written in complete detail if you go with the Salesforce documentation. But if I show you the output of this, let's see how exactly it works. I have my account record. So if I go to any of the account record, you can always edit this page, your record page. So these were the, if you see by default, you get related details or news if you have, but yes, you always have an option to add new tabs. So if you click here, these are the option of tabs. So you can always click on add tabs and add a new tab. Let me just show you quickly. You can just click on this detail. You can say custom label. I could name it as tab demo, and I click on it as done. Now a new tab is created, and you can always drag drop your components. So whatever Lightning web components you have created, you can always do a drag drop and just click on save. Okay. So I have already created those tabs. Already added those component in LWC demo 18 and 19. Okay, But if you want to add more, you can always create a tab and drop your component. Let's save it and let's see our preview. If I go to our demo 18, so we have written only 4 lines of code, nothing special. So your record ID, as it is a public property, so it automatically takes up that record ID. So if you want to print it as well, you can print it, use it somewhere. So those things are possible. So whatever I could say fields you have onto the layouts, those are getting displayed automatically. And we give the mode as read mode. So let me just show you quickly. Sorry, view mode. So we give the mode as view mode. So it's like non-editable. But if you want to edit it, just click on any of the field and everything changes to editable mode. You can always change something and click on save. Okay. So this is how it works. Now, in my this lightning component in record form, I have hard coded this account. So definitely I cannot use this on opportunity and all. This is not a generic one. But yes, if you want to make it a generic one, definitely you can use this property object API name, and you can give the object API name here. So I have included it one of the demo. So we'll discuss on that as well. So if you want to read a record using your Lightning record form, so this is the way directly you can use it. If someone say that we have to override this detail, definitely you can remove it and you can create your own detail tab and put a Lightning web component there. So this would help you to create some kind of customization that whenever a save happen, you want to perform something or some UI changes and all. So if you want to override the standard stuff, definitely you can make use of these record forms. Okay, moving on to the next. So we have another base component is Lightning record view form. It's similar to that, but yes, in this case we were seeing all our fields which were there. But if you want to view only certain fields or few fields onto our screen, then definitely this Lightning record view form can help you. And also if you want to make them as read only, that means you do not want to give edit access to your users, you just want to display the record. So there, this Lightning record view form plays a big role. So again, it has a few of the attributes. So I have passed this record ID. It will automatically come from our framework. Will put that ID based on the record which we are viewing. Object API name, I have hard coded it. And now I have included our SLDS to create a grid. And I have included our I have included this Lightning output field. So what this Lightning output field do? Whatever API name you provided, it display your records accordingly. So I have hard coded the API names, but you have an option to, I could say, make it dynamic, that if I want few of the fields, I can do that. We'll talk about that as well. Okay. So I have included name, phone, industry, and annual revenue field. Okay. So what it will do, basically whichever record will view, it will display all these 4 fields into non-editable mode, or I could say read-only mode, where you don't have option to edit them. Okay, so let me just save it and push it. So in this case, definitely you do not require anything into your JavaScript files. If you want to include this only, just include this, nothing is required into your JavaScript file. Okay. Just deploy the changes quickly. Okay, let me quickly refresh this. If you see, I have my another form which is coming up. So load a record using our Lightning View form, and it's totally read only. So you do not have an option to edit it. Okay. So if you want to display any of the values, you can always use this. You don't have to do a DML and all. It's like it display the complete record. Okay. Quickly moving on to the third. Now here we have made few more changes. Like here we were giving a field name, but instead of field name, I don't want to use a Lightning output field. Maybe I want to make some customization that if my name field come up, I want to append something, or I want to change some formats, or I want to append some letters into it. So want to make it a, I could say uppercase, lowercase. So if I want to make any kind of changes, definitely we cannot directly use it because it directly pull a value from your database and display that. But if we have our changes which you want to put, so we can use a same the Lightning record view form. But if you see the record ID also I have given, and here instead of hard coding, now I have used this object API name. So these public properties remain fixed. Your Salesforce push the values into them. So it pushed the record ID and the API name. So if you put it anywhere, it's like your API name will keep on changing based on the record page with where you are putting it. Okay. Now, if you see here, I have not used our Lightning output field. Okay. I have not used the Lightning output field. I have used Lightning formatted text, Lightning formatted number, and again, Lightning formatted text. So we are displaying our industry value, revenue, and name. Okay. So what these are basically, as you are aware, like these are all the properties which are available in your JavaScript file. So I'm not using directly the input or output fields, but I am using a property. Okay. Now here, definitely these must be, these are, we have declared them into our JavaScript file, and let's see how exactly we use them. Okay. So another important thing, if you use this, definitely we need to get the record. Okay, definitely we need to get the record. So here we have this UI record API. So we have this Lightning UI record API, and let me quickly show you the documentation we have for this. Okay, so if you go to references, and we have this Lightning UI API, this is the one which we have, UI record API. So these are I could say already written into your Salesforce. Now we use our wire adapters directly and we use them. So if you want to get a record, you want to get a particular field value, you want to delete a record, you want to create a record, you want to update a record, these are the things we'll be using. I have demo for few, not for all, but yes, I have demo for few of creating a record and getting a record. So what exactly these are useful? So if we have to get a record into our JavaScript, that means if you use your these record forms and all, there you do not need any of your JavaScript thing. But yes, in these cases, definitely we need the values. We want to manipulate them, or we want to customize them according to our need. And then we want to display them onto the UI. So definitely for manipulation, you need to get them into the JavaScript file and then do those manipulation. So there is no way to directly get it. So what we do there, we make use of this UI record API, which help us to get those value. Okay. So if I talk about this get record, now definitely you must be thinking how we are writing this and how exactly it is working. So you always have an option to go to this documentation. It will show you, it will give you a basically the syntax for it, and it will also give you an example for it. Like this is a similar example which I have taken, which I am explaining you. It will also give you an example Okay, so moving on to our code. So what this get record do? It takes the record ID. Now, what we have done here, if you actually whenever we use a wire, those properties are reactive. Okay. Now, if I want to make it a dynamic, so let me explain you in a simple word. That means if any time this record ID which we are using get changed, anytime this record ID get changed, this wire service will execute again. It will call this method and will get the updated value. Okay, so we are making it dynamic basically. So anytime you push a new record ID, your wire service will work, it will query your database, and it will return you the result. Okay, now first is your record ID, that means which record you want to get. Second is what fields you want to get. Okay, so second is what fields you want to get, and whenever you get a record, where you want to save it. So we are saving it into a my record property, and basically this property is reactive by default. That means anything is changed into my record, your UI will re-render and display the value. Okay, now let's talk about these fields, what these are. So there are two ways of using this field. One is, let me just go through this concept first and then we'll go through another. What I have done, I have taken a constant, I have taken all fields, which is my array, and here I am giving my API name and field name. So account.name, account.annualrevenue. If you have anything like custom, you have to put underscore underscore C. Okay, so I have taken a constant, I have given few fields name, and what you do, you just pass this array into the fields. So what Salesforce will do, it will call this wire service, it will get the record, and it will get all these fields. Okay, so let me just push it and show you first. And so what if you see our changes, basically these are the record which we are getting using our get record using our wire service. So we are getting the name, we are getting what we say the annual revenue and the name. Okay, now so here we have taken the fields. Now there's a difference. So another way is, I could say you can put it like this, your API name and your field API. Another is you can import those fields. So we have our schema, I could say library, which is there. So from there, we are importing our account object schema, then we are importing our these fields as well. The difference when to use what, the best, like it's good, and as a best practice, it's good to use the fields after importing. The reason behind that is, anytime you are trying to delete a field, okay, these are standard field, definitely we cannot delete them. But if I talk about any of our custom fields, so if you are deleting a field, if you put them like these array, your sales, I could say a Salesforce will not able to identify where this field has been used, because this is like a normal array. But if you import them, and if you try to delete a field, you can easily identify that, okay, this field has been referenced into that Lightning Web component. Okay, so if you use this approach and your field is deleted, this component will be errored out. But if you use the import approach, and if you delete the field, you will get to know, okay, I'm referencing my field here, I have to remove the reference from here as well, and then only I can delete that field. Okay, so we are passing these field names. So if you see here, this import, we are giving some value. Basically, you can give any name here, and this is like a reference for your account name field. Revenue field, this is like a reference for your account revenue. So this is not has to be a revenue underscore field always. You can give your name as well, but yes, we are just following the best practices so that if someone see your code, they will able to identify, okay, this is what you have done. Okay. So you, whenever you use get record, it query it, your record is saved here. And then we have another service which is get field value. So you have to import that as well. So what this get field value do? You give it a complete record. Okay, you give it a complete record. Now, whenever we use a wire service, whatever output we get, we have to use dot data. So your actual result is present into your data value, sorry, data property. So you have to use this dot my record dot data, and you have to give your field name. So what exactly this will do? This will get the field value from your returned record and will assign it to name value. So if you remember, we did getter and setter properties. Okay, we did getter and setter properties. So here I'm just creating a getter property. That means name value is one of my property which exists onto the UI. Same goes with industry and same goes with revenue as well. Okay. And another important thing, anytime you're confused, like where I have to use data, where I don't have to use data, the best thing is do a console.log, json.stringify, and display it. There it will give you a complete response in a form of your string. And you can always use that where you have to use dot data, where you have to use detail field. So everything will become easy. Okay. So this is how we use our get record to read a record. And this is how we can use our wire service as well. We'll talk more about wire service in Apex as well. So if you see my screen, this is getting displayed. Okay. And let me quickly change something. Demo. Okay. So you must have seen this. The moment I change it, okay, the moment I change something, so I'm just changing into our one lightning form which was on top. So here I have taken three. If you see the code, the HTML, I have taken three. The first and second part are like standalone, they do not require any JavaScript. But yes, here we are using the JavaScript as well. So if you see here, here this LDS plays a big role. So if I make any of the change here, okay, so if I make any of the change here in one component and I save it, automatically my another component also get re-rendered. Okay, so here LDS always check for your data which is there into a database, and accordingly it get you the updated values as well. Okay. So this is all we have about our three components for read. Now we'll quickly go through our edit as well as create components. So I'll be a bit quick on them because those are a bit similar. Okay. And then I want to spend more time on to our Apex because that is being the most important part. So opening our another demo. How exactly we can edit the record using our base component. So this is a very small one which I have taken. The first is again the record form and mode I have given it as edit. So whatever will come up, it will come in an editable mode. Here I have taken a compact layout. So whatever fields will come up, whatever you have onto the compact layout, those fields will come up. Okay. So this is the first part. Second, again, using the, so here we cannot use a record view form. So that is used for our, I could say view purpose only. Okay. Second use of record view form. If you see here, you can also put the fields. That means this is your object API, this is your record. Now, which all fields you want to display. Okay. So if you have any of the particular field, you don't want to use the layouts. In that case, you do not use the layout type, but use this field attribute and give it a value. So what we have done in these fields, here I have taken the same thing. So I have created a property and I have taken it like an array and included my four account fields. Okay. So this can be used to display as well a particular set of fields. Third, I am using the record edit form, using the lightning input field with them, passing directly these the field APIs. Okay, and I have a submit button as well. So whenever I click on submit, it basically update this record. Okay, so you have to take everything into the form. So if you see here, your lightning record edit forms start from here and ends here. Lightning message is something, if you have seen the Visual Force page, we used to have Apex messages. So any errors you have, that comes up onto the screen there. Similarly, these lightning messages also work. So if you have any kind of errors and all, those will pop up at this place where you have including lightning message. And if you don't include lightning message, then definitely you have an option to handle the error, get those messages, and you can use a toast event and all to display those errors as well. So these things you can easily get into your the documentation as well. Okay, let me quickly just show you this, how exactly it works. It's similar to your what we have done in viewing the record, but here we have the edit and we are using the record edit form here. Okay, so this is your first form, which always comes in editable mode. But yes, if you change something and save it, it goes to your view mode. But yes, by default, it will come to your editable mode. Okay. Second, we took the same record form and we passed the fields. So instead of using the complete layout, we are just using few of the fields. So you always have the option to use them. Third, we are using a record edit form. So with your record edit form, you can use output field and input fields. If you want to make few fields read only, use output field. If you want to make them open or editable, you can always use this input fields. Okay, and once I click on save, it gets saved, and it, even if you see, it display at other places as well. Okay, talking about JavaScript, nothing special I have taken. Two public properties, these get a value from your framework if you use it onto the record page. And in second, I am using a fields with our record form. So there I am passing this field array that I want these fields only. Okay, so this is what we have done, and it's all similar. Okay, so that's why I'm not putting more time onto this. It's totally similar to you what we have seen into the record view form. Okay, so moving on to the next. So next we have our record edit form. So create records, again we use our record edit form and record form. And then I also created another demo to create record using wire service. So we'll just see more onto this. So let's quickly complete this create record. So if you see here, definitely in create record, we do not have our record ID. So that's why that record ID property or attribute is not there. So we are creating a record and record ID will be created. And what I have done, so I have taken it like a property, and in property, I have taken it a account object. So I have imported account object. I have assigned it to one of the property and I am using this property here. Okay, so if you want to make it more dynamic, you can always pass it from parent as well and use it. Okay, fields, again the same concept. I have taken the my fields as an array, and here I am using only one field, the name field, and one more field we have, the website field. So I have two fields here. Okay, then I have taken on success. So definitely you are creating a record, you want to get the ID and perform something else, so you need a record. So what I have done, so I have called on success and handle account created. So what I am doing here, again I told you, like if you are all confused what to print, go for json.stringify. So what I did, json.stringify, and you can also do event or event.detail. And from there, you can use the ID. Why I used it? Basically, it takes a small I, and I was giving it capital, and I was not able to find the reason why it is not giving it correctly. Then I do a json.stringify and just update it to the ID. So these are the, I could say, few tricks as well to debug your components. Okay. So what this will do, it will show me one component which will have two fields. Whenever I click on save, it will create a record and it will display a record. So this is what we have in record form. Then I told you record, you can always use a record edit form as well to create a record. So I have given object API, on success remains same. And here I am using the input fields. Okay. And I am using a submit button. So whenever you use your edit form, you have to include these buttons as well into the form. It will ask for name and website, and when once I press submit, it will create a record into the system. Whenever success happened, it will call this account record created and display our ID. Okay. Now, definitely you can create one of the property. You can always assign this, and later it can be used to perform multiple stuff. So we'll talk about it. I have done this in Apex. I have created a demo there. So we'll talk about that. Okay. Let me quickly run this. So your create record, definitely you do not need to put it onto your record layout, record page. You can put it on any of our app builder page as well. So I'll be doing the same. I have this LWC day 4 page, which I have set up.
Sahil, just one thing. Some people are facing lag between speech and the screen share. Must be network issue, but I would just say if you can give a pause for 5 seconds and then okay, continue.
Sure.
That should be fine.
Yeah. So I am putting this record form and record edit form. So it's like the two fields which we have taken. I put test.com and I save it. So my record get created, and this being the record form, it takes the record ID automatically and display it here as well. Now, if you change something, this work like an edit now. Okay, so it automatically takes up. But if I talk about record edit form, I do a create account. Basically, the account has been created, but you have to control, like once it has been successful or once this button has been clicked, what you have to do. But if I show you a log, let me just clear it and okay. So once I do a create account, if you see, this is my json.stringify. It gives lot of all values, and as I told you, I was making a mistake in ID. So from here I get to know I have to make a small I. So definitely you can use this if you face some issues. So do a stringify, and you can always get those values what exactly you have to use. And it also gives us the account ID which has been created. It also gives us the account ID which has been created. So this is how your record, I could say, form works for creating a record. Now I could say we'll now move to our most important part of our today's session. One is creating an account record, creating a record using the wire service first thing, and then how we use Apex. So I'll be a bit slow in that. This is something which already existing, and it's nothing like a rocket science in that. So I just move these demos quickly, but it's now we'll just see how exactly the things works, and we'll have more time there. Okay. So moving on to our next demo, which is like how exactly you can create a record using your wire service. Let me open one of our demo 21, which I have created. What I have done here, no base components. I have not taken any of the base component. I have taken normal inputs which we have always used. So I've taken a lightning input. I have disabled it. If you see here, I have disabled it and I have given a value as account ID. Okay. Second, for creation of account, name is the most, I could say more, name is the important field or required field. So I have taken only one field, but if you want more, definitely I can create my own custom form using our lightning inputs. So I have taken the label as name, and whenever it is changed, I want to pass the value from my HTML file to JavaScript. So that's why I have included a change handler. Then I have also created a lightning button, named it as create account. And whenever I click on it, it creates an account. So this is pretty much, if you relate with our session one or two, those are the things. Nothing with, I could say, specific to the base components or LDS. Okay. But if I go to our JavaScript file, this is one of my property. This is one of my function or method, you can say. This is another. So if I go here, I have a account ID. Okay. Name, I have taken it. So but I'm not given a value here, but I have taken one of the property as name, because if you want to use it somewhere, we can use it. Now, handle name change. Whenever you change the name, that means you type something into the input, your change handler will be called and it will assign that value to our name property. Okay. So event.target.values. If you remember my first session, we did it in like how exactly we can get a value from our HTML to the JavaScript. It's the same concept. Okay. Now comes the, I could say, most important concept. So in our previous demo, we were using our wire service. Okay. Here I am making a imperative call. So we'll talk about both of the things in Apex. You will get to know. So here I'm not using wire. Here I'm making an imperative call. So what I have done in it, so whenever you click onto a button, whenever you click onto a button, it calls the method create account. In this, I have taken the one of the constant fields. It's a empty array. Okay. Then one option is either you can, let me just comment this out. One option is, if you want to keep it simple, you can use constant fields. Whatever fields you have and whatever values you have, you can pass it like this. Okay. So you can always pass them like this. So this is first option. If you don't want to use it, you want to go with the standard what we have. I have declared a field constant, basically like a variable. Then what I am doing in my name field, I am putting this value. Similarly, you have to put this value in annual revenue. Okay, annual revenue inactive. So you have to import those field first, and you have to assign those values. Okay. Once you have done with that, you pass that field here, and you have to pass this object API as well. That means I want to create a record, but for which account? Sorry, for but what for which object? So there we have to pass the API name as well. So that's why I'm doing it account object dot object API name. How you get it? This is already written into documentation as well. But yes, if you get some doubt and all, you can always do a json.stringify of this account object, and it will show you how exactly you can get a API name. Okay, you can always do a console.log. And you can put this account object, and there it will just display you how exactly you can get a API. Okay. Then I have created a record input. So in your record input, whatever field value you have to give, you have to pass those and the API names, and you have to pass this record input to your create record. So this is already existing into your Salesforce. So whatever record input you pass, then whatever you see here, this then and catch. So we call them as promises. Okay, we call them as promise. And whatever call you see here, this is basically a imperative call, which always return promise. So what this promise is basically, whenever you make a call, this is like a syntax which is there, which help us to handle your response as well as error. So if you have your response, that means there is no error. Your then part will execute. If you have some error, then your catch part will execute. Okay. So what will happen? This will call this create record. It will insert a record and it will return the account ID. Basically, it returns the complete record and you are getting the account ID from here. So I am assigning it to one of the property which I have created onto the top, this account ID, and I am also displaying a toast event. Okay, so whenever we have to display a toast event, we have this platform show toast event library which is there. You have to import show toast event from that. Okay, so make sure if you use them, do a import. What will happen if you don't import them? It do not throw any of the syntax error, but it do not work as well. Okay. Whenever you use something which is standard, make sure you import them. Okay, so I have imported show toast event as well. So what exactly it will do? It will take the name. Once I click on create account, it will put these values into the field and all. We are passing the API name and all the field values. It will create a record. You don't have to worry about it. What has been, how it has been doing it and all. It's already written into Salesforce. This record will get created. It return us the promise. So this is how we handle the promise which has been returned. So if it is a success, whatever you get in response will be stored into account. You can name it anything. I can give my name or data or details or anything here. It will work. And from there, I am taking the account.id. And anytime you have a confusion, do a json.stringify of this account and you will get what structure it has and you can accordingly use it. Okay, if there is some error, you can always display error into the toast event or put it in any of the property and display those errors. So there it plays a role. So here we are not using a wire, here we are using an imperative call, and we'll see that how these two can be used in our Apex as well. So I have two good demo about them as well. Okay, so let me just show you how exactly it work and how it look like. I'll just edit my page and quickly put my component. So I have my component on my page. ID is non-editable because it is disabled. Name is there. I just give it a name and I just click on create account. Okay. The moment I click on create account, what happens? It call my create account record method or function which is written in JavaScript. It make an imperative call to my create record. So if you see here, this is the one. It make an imperative call to the create record. Okay. Now, when it make an imperative call, the record is created. It returns us with the response. So we handle that response into our JavaScript. So we are handling that response here, and we are assigning the account ID to my account ID property. And this is like, as we have seen, that primitive properties are reactive in nature. If something is changed, automatically it comes onto the screen. So your account ID automatically comes up and we cannot change it because it's in disable mode. Okay. So this is how you can use to create the records that you can use these already existing stuff. You can import them, use these methods, okay, which are there in UI record API. Now, moving on to the next, how exactly we can call Apex. So I could say that would be the most common scenario which comes in every project and where we have to hit our Apex and use it. So again, we can make a call in two ways, via an imperative call. Then whenever you make a call to any of the Apex method, you have to import that. So you have to give it a Apex method name. Again, this Apex method name, which comes after import, this is like representation of which basically represent your Apex method. You can give any name here, but it's a good practice to give a similar name what you have given it for your Apex method. Then add the red Salesforce Apex. If you have any of the namespace, you can give that. Your class name, which you have taken, and your method name. Now, the most important thing, as you have seen in Aura, we have to use Aura enabled. So any method which you want to use in Lightning Web Component, you have to use annotation Aura enabled. So that is the most important. Now, so to call a Apex method, we can wire a property, we can wire a function. We'll see both of them. I have them in demo. And we can even call a method, so we can make an imperative call to our method as well. So these are the, so it's two ways, wire and imperative call. But in using the wire adapter, there are two ways of writing it. So we'll see both of them, okay? Plus the imperative call, it's like what we have seen in create record, it's a similar stuff, but yes. Now we'll compare them as well, when to use wire, when to use imperative, okay? So we'll talk about in brief about them as well, okay? So moving on to our demo, calling Apex using wire. So there's one thing with your wire service, okay? With your wire service, so any method which you use with your wire service, all your data which is written by your wire service are cached by default, okay? So you have to include cacheable equal to true into your Apex class if you are making a wire call. So you have to use @aura enabled for both of them, but yes, if you are making a wire call, you have to make cacheable equal to true for in your Apex on your Apex method. So let me just show you that quickly. What I have done, I have let me just close this. I have created a demo. I have created one of my Apex class as well. And whatever demo I have taken, I could say this is my favorite demo. So what I always used to do, I used to get all account record, create a combo box out of it. That means a pick list, which display you the records. Then whatever record I select, I get the related context as well for those account, a selected account, okay? So here we'll be covering multiple concepts. One is I have created two methods. I will be doing a wire call, so I have made a cacheable equal to true for both of them. Aura enabled, if you want to use them, definitely you have to put Aura enabled. My first method, pretty much simple, it returned me 10 account records, okay? Second method, I am passing a parameter as well. So we'll cover the concept of how values of the parameters are passed. Now these parameters could be your, what we say, primitive, any of your S object, and third could be your collections as well. So it could be anything. So here I have taken an example of primitive. So whatever account ID I have passed, I query the related contacts and return those contact in a form of list. Okay, so you can return a list, you can return a map as well, but I'm returning a list here, okay? So this is what we have in Apex. The main important thing, Aura enabled, cacheable equal to true because we are using wire. And yes, another important thing, if you are using writing these methods which you have to call, those should be either public or global, and they should be static. It's a compulsion, they should be static. They can be either public or global. Okay, so these are the few things. Now, moving on to our HTML and JavaScript code. Okay, so moving on to our HTML and JavaScript code. So first is I have created a combo box. Okay, this is like a standard component which is there. Value, so whatever value is being selected, it gets stored into my value property. Placeholder, if you want to give anything, but that means if you don't have anything by default, you can give a placeholder. But I have a value, so you will not able to see this placeholder. Label, which will come onto the top of the field. Then we have options. That means in my pick list, what all values should be there. Okay, in my pick list, what all values should be present. Okay. Then we have on change. That means whenever I change a particular value, it will call a particular function. Okay. So this is the first part where I am trying to create a pick list. So all my pick list values comes into options. If I change something, it call handle change. And if I change something, if you remember, your pick list always have a label and value. Your value will go and get stored here. That means if I select first account, its ID will go and get stored here. Now, first we'll see how this has been created. Okay, so there we are using the wire. Now, talking more about wire. So whenever your component get loaded, these wire properties will execute and try to get everything. Okay, we'll try to get the data. First time, definitely it goes with multiple stuff. So there could be few changes as well. We'll talk about it. I have an imperative call and there I have used rendered callback. We'll talk about that as well. But yes, if you see here, we are using @ wire. Then you have to use this get account list. So whatever import statement you give, your get account list reference your Apex controller method. So I have given account controller and my method name. Now, as I told you in my PPT, let me just go to a PPT. You can either wire a property or you can wire a function as well. Okay, so this is the example, which is the first one is wiring a function. That means you call this and whatever you get, I have written it in a form of function. Okay, I have written it in a form of function. So we are passing array and error and data. Now if it is an error, it will come here. So that means if your response is correct, there is no error, you will get everything in data, your response will come here. If you have some error, you will get it in a error variable. So if you want to handle it, you always have an option. If error, and you can just do console.log maybe. You can handle error like this, okay? So once you get the response, now what we'll get in response, basically a complete list of account records, which has 10 records. So I have created one temporary variable. I have given the label as none and value as none. So this is first thing. By default, I'm giving a value as none. So what will happen? Once my screen loads, it will show you the none option as selected. Okay, that's why I've given the value as default value as none. And this is my first element. Now this is a ECMAScript or modern JavaScript concept we have. And what happens, this mute, if you mute, change something, or if you, I could say values are mutated or changed. In that case, sometimes we face issues. We have to use @track and those stuff. So what I have done here, basically this is a syntax, what it do. So I have taken this and it's very useful as well. If you face issues with display of the record, that means your pick list comes up, it only show none and it do not display you the all the 10 records. Definitely the track and those things could be complex, which one to put, how those are working. So what this do, basically whatever you have in option, that means whatever you have in array plus new element, combine everything. So as of now, in my first screen, my array option is blank. So what will happen? blank plus my first element. So my this dot option will have only one element now. So that is there. But now if I iterate over my list, so whatever list I am iterating over my list. So here you have to use these modern JavaScript concept to iterate over your basically arrays. So I'm using the same thing, variable item of data. That means we'll iterate over each and every account one by one. I'm creating this account record where I'm giving a label and a value. And again, I have included this. So what it will do? First time it will take none value, add my first account, put it into my options. So every time it create a new instance, okay? Every time it create a new instance, a copy of, I could say, the earlier one and put it into a new instance. So there you have seen that if any of your properties change, if you don't put a track as well, it works. So the same thing will happen here. It will work. Okay. If you have some error, definitely you can print them. So what this will do, whenever your page loads, your wire property or wire service will run, it will get everything and create your pick list. So it put everything into your options, and now this options is used to give a value to your pick list. So the same thing is happening there. Let me quickly show you the screen, onto the screen, how exactly it will come. I will edit a page. Okay, let me quickly put it. Okay. I'm just putting the two more demos so that I do not waste more time here in test of time. But we'll talk about them one by one. So as of now, just demo 22. So what will happen whenever it loads? It put my 10 records. Okay, it put my 10 records. So my wire service will automatically run and it put my 10 records. Now what we have here into my code, if something is changed, I am calling a handle change. Okay, if I do a select a particular value, definitely my value will get changed. The new ID, the account ID will be your account ID will be assigned to your value property, and this on change will work. Now in on change, what I have done, this dot value is equal to event dot detail dot value. So we are getting the value from our UI, and then again I am using the wire property. Okay, now as I told you, whenever we use this with our dollar sign, it make it dynamic. What it means, anytime the value which is present into your value property is changed, okay, that means your IDs are changed, it will call this wire service again and again. What that wire service do? It will call your get related contact. That means if you see here the import, it will call your get related contact. We are passing our account ID, so we are making it dynamic. So whatever our current value is, pass that, and whatever comes up, whatever result comes up, store it in all contacts. So this is like wiring a property. So we are wiring a property directly instead of our method. We can write it in this way as well, or directly we can write it in this manner as well. Okay, so what will happen, it will pass this record ID, my account ID, query all my contact records, and will assign this to all contacts. Now what this all contacted contacts is, this will act like a reactive property. So whenever you use these properties with wire, these will act like a reactive property. That means if something is changed in them, your rendering or UI will automatically get re-render. Okay, so I select a value, handle change get called, my value get changed. If my value get changed, this wire service will call this method again and get my updated contacts. Okay, so let me just show you what we have in this. So if I select any point, I get my contact. If I select edge point, I get my two other contact. Okay, so this is how it is working. So you select a particular account, you get a contact related to it, and all contacts is it's the same thing which we have seen in our earlier demo. I am using a for each, and as I told you, your wire always return you the response, and your main response is there in data. So you always have to use dot data with your wire service. Okay. So here, everything comes here directly into this data. But yes, in case of you use binding using wire service property directly, how we are using it here, you have to use dot data. So this is something you have to keep in mind, like considered like a syntax and all. And if you are, if you do not get what to use, json.stringify do it for all contexts, and it will just show you that okay, this is what you have to write or use. But yes, whenever you use wire service, you have to use dot data with it. Okay, so this we have in wire service. Now the similar demo I have created to give a imperative call. Okay, so for imperative call, what I have done, I have created another controller where I have not taken cacheable equal to true. It's good to take cacheable equal to true because it will increase our performance. But yes, if you want, every time it should hit your database, get the updated values, you can just remove that cacheable equal to true and you can make use of imperative call. And another important thing, we'll talk about it, but like when difference between our imperative and wire. So let's do one more demo and then let's talk about it. So I have created a Apex class, account controller imperative, same thing, nothing is changed into this. Here I have removed the cacheable equal true and here I have included. So you can use cacheable equal true with imperative as well. That's why I've added it for one method, and for another I have not added it. Okay, so this is a similar class which you have seen. So I'm just closing it so that let's open our demo. Okay, again the HTML remains same, no change into the HTML, but how exactly we are creating this pick list? Because imperative calls, you cannot do a call directly. What happens whenever your component load, the wire service executes and get those data there. Okay, but in this case, we have to make a call. We have to make an imperative call to our Apex. And what we have done here, we have used our lifecycle methods. Okay, we have used our lifecycle method here. So whenever our complete DOM is rendered, we have a method rendered callback which is called. So that method I have used here. So let me show you that. Okay, so same thing, I have taken a value, all contact options. The handle changes there, we'll talk about it, but let's talk about how exactly we are getting our initial pick list. Okay, so if you see rendered callback, whenever something is rendered, rendered callback will call again. Now in our case, whenever I change a pick list value, it will re-render. So this rendered callback will be called. So anything is re-rendered, this rendered callback will be called. Now to prevent it calling again and again, okay, so to prevent it for like it should not get called again and again, what I have done, whenever my component get loaded first time, my options will be a blank array. Okay, it will be a blank array. So what I have done, I have taken if this dot option dot length is zero, then only perform this operation. That means I am calling my Apex method only when it is initially loaded. So there was a query in into our query sheet that if you want to load some initial data, what we should do. This is something you can follow. Okay, you can put it in a rendered callback. Your data is blank. So here I've just added a options this array length check. That means if it is initial load, then only perform this. how exactly we make an imperative call. I told you it return a promise record. So it's like get account list. I'm calling my method. Then it has a then, and then it has a catch. Okay. So in then, I have taken a data. Now this could be anything. It could be any variable. Earlier, if you have seen create account, create record, there I have taken account, here I have taken it as data. If my data is present, I am just following the same concept. This is not a wire call. The main thing between the wire and imperative, it return promise, you have to use dot then dot catch. But yes, the logic which you have written inside, that remains same. Okay, so I'm just iterating over my complete list and putting them in an options array. And what will happen? My option will get re-rendered. Okay. So if I talk about UI, the same thing happens. If you see this demo 23 onto the right-hand side, bottom most, demo 22 and 23 is same, but yes, the change is we are making an imperative call and we have all our accounts present here. Now if I select any of the account, it give me a particular contact. So if you see here, I am getting these contact record. Now what happens on change? So let's see that code. So whenever change happens, we get the value. Okay, we get the value. Now in our earlier in our wire case, we have that dollar value. So what happened? If that value property is changed, anything which is assigned to a value property gets changed, it execute that wire service again, call your apex method. But here we have to explicitly call it. So what I have done here, so I have written get related contact, passing the account ID as this dot value, same thing, dot then data. So whatever I get, I do all contacts. And here you do not have to use dot data and all, so promises do not have to use that. Okay, so directly whatever is being written, you can assign it to all contexts, and here you have to display all contexts. So in my wire, I was using dot data here, but in case of imperative call, directly you have to use all contexts. Okay, so your handle change works, your value get updated, you make a call, and it display your contact records. Okay, now if I talk about our difference, when to use what. So mostly whenever you want to read the records and all, your wire service is used, you cache them, it will be there into your cache. Okay, it will be there into your cache, and if you want to get them again, it uses cache and increase the performance. But if you want to make some DMLs, that means insert, update, delete, there your cache doesn't play a big role. So there you can make use of imperative calls. Okay, so there you can make use of the imperative calls. So anytime you have to perform some DMLs, insert, update, delete, go with your imperative call. And if you want to get those records, if something is changed, that the value was changing, you can get those. And where value was changing, it was automatically calling it. If you want to call your wire service on load, there you can use wire for your initial data load and all those stuff. Another thing with wire is, if you see here, I have written almost 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 or 7 line of code. Okay, but in case of wire, we just wrote @ wire get record count. We passed this and being added a property name. It was done in one line, so it reduced the number of lines of code as well if you use wire. Okay, so there you can decide which one you want to use and how you want to use. You can also combine both of them. At one place you can use wire, and at another place you can use imperative as well. So that is also possible. Okay, so that totally depends on requirement, what you have to use, when you have to use. Okay, but yes, your wire data is cached. It store it in a cache, and anytime you make the changes and all, it takes it from the cache, and if it some changes are there, so there you have to see that how exactly it works. I will just show you one more example, the next example. So what we have in our next example, let me show you that, and that will help you to understand and the problem and how we resolve that problem. It will help you to understand that as well. Okay. So it's like 6 p.m. I will just take 10 more minutes. Okay, just 10 more minutes and we'll be done with the session. I have created one of the class which return me the account records where annual revenue is more than 0.2 million or 2 lakh, whatever you say. Then I have created a so here I have included cacheable equal to 2. So I will be calling it using our wire service. Okay, another method I have created. So what I am doing, wherever the annual revenue is more than 2 lakh, I am just updating the active field. Okay, let me just make it to yes, because I done it. I will just make it make the change, and we'll see that change as well. Okay, so I will get the records using our wire service. Then I am firing an update. What this update will do? It will update all of my account records where and update the value of active as yes. Okay, so this is one thing. Now moving on to our component. Okay, demo 24. So what I have done here, first I am using the wire service. If you see here, only one line of code which will execute my first method to get me all the account records where annual revenue is more than 2 lakh. Okay, so it will get in all accounts, then I am iterating on them and displaying them. Let me just comment out few stuff so that you understand it well. Okay, so as of now we have used our wire service to get all the account records where your annual revenue is more than 2 lakh. Okay, now if I just refresh it, so if you see here, these are my accounts and your active field is no in everything. Okay, so this is one part which we have already seen. Now I have included a update active button. What it do? It basically make a imperative call to our Apex method. It makes an imperative call to our Apex method and update this active to yes. Okay, so let me click on it. So I have clicked on it, nothing happened. You can see the screen, nothing happened. So this is a problem which we might face whenever we use wire and imperative together. So nothing happened. Your record has been changed at the backend. If you want to confirm, if you see this Burlington, it was already yes. Let's take Genie Point. Okay, let's take Genie Point. Let me just refresh this. I have already a list view. Here also there is a cache issue. Just give me a second, I made some mistake or something. Okay, I didn't deploy this, that is the reason it is not showing. So I'm just making it active as yes. Okay, so let me just quickly show you again, clearing a cache, refreshing it. So everything is no. Now I click on update active. So what happens? My method has been called, and let me just show you all accounts. Now, if you see here, Burlington, Edge Communication, Genie Point, everything as active as yes. But if you see our UI, nothing got updated. So if you we have seen that it happens in case of wire, that if something is what we say, if something is updated into a database, it will come up. But yes, for your, it store everything in cache. You have that time and all, but the data which is there, it's now obsolete, which is of not, I could say, perfect one. So if I, one thing is do a full refresh of your page or of your component, then you get everything, yes. Okay. But if you get into this situation, we have something known as Apex Refresh. Okay. We have Apex Refresh. So what this Apex, Refresh Apex. What exactly it do? It is used to, so your Refresh Apex is used to get your wired data. That means you have your, this wire property, all accounts. This is used to get the value of this all accounts from your database. That means the updated value. Even if your cache, it's stored in your cache and all, if you want to get that updated data onto your screen, you use this Refresh Apex. Make sure you import it. The thing we have to do, you have to just write return Refresh Apex and you have to give your property name, this wired property. Okay. Now, once I save it, let me just deploy this. Plus, we have already made it as yes. So let me made it as no so that we may see the change. Now I'm deploying this as well. Now quickly refreshing it. So earlier, once we update it, it was not coming onto our UI, but your Refresh Apex, make sure it hit the database, get updated value, update the wired property and get it onto your UI, okay? So what it do, basically it calls your method, re-query all the records, and display them. Okay, so if I click on update active, you will see it has changed to no same time. Okay, so this is how your Refresh Apex works. Whenever you use your imperative call and these wired call like together, you may run into these kind of issues, and this is how you can resolve that issue. Okay. So this is all we have for today's session. So you can just post your query into the same sheet. And another important thing, so we have our next session on next Thursday. There I'll be covering our navigations, like how you can go to record page, to external website, any of the other records. So we'll see that. We'll also see how exactly we can use our Lightning Web components inside our Aura components. How we pass data between them, that means how we handle those events, because it's different for both, and some extra topics like using a third party libraries. So I will take an example of chart.js. We'll put that chart.js into a static resource and try to create some charts using chart.js. okay, and few more references I will give you, the next step, how exactly you can start go into this more advanced concept, learn LWC in more depth. Okay, and we'll be conducting one quiz as well, and so it would be like based on what you have learned so far, the PPTs and those few questions would be from there. So Nishan will be conducting that quiz, and you can win swags as well. So that's all I have for today. So thank you everyone. So see you on next Thursday. And we'll upload the recording as well as the code into the this GitHub. Recording will be uploaded by Nishant into our YouTube. So Nishant, over to you.
Yeah, thanks everyone. Thanks for joining. Thanks Shahil. Wonderful session today. Really great insights you brought in. Do join us live on next session on next Thursday so that you can get opportunity to learn more and maybe win some swag in the quiz. Rest you can catch up on the recordings on the YouTube. That's it. Thanks everyone. Thanks for joining.